resurrection, her ascension, and her glorification. At the end of her earthly life, Archangel Gabriel came to the Virgin Mary. The third time the Archangel had come to Mary and told her that in 3 days her divine Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, wished her to be with him. So the Ever-Virgin Mary prepared herself for the leave-taking of her biological life. She peacefully, without any pain, any sorrow, any illness, any affliction, she gave her soul unto the Lord. The Lord came and took her soul. The apostles came from all over the world, carried on clouds from different parts. They assembled in Gethsemane. They buried her there. And Thomas, who was late, the apostle, he came later. They opened the tomb. The tomb was empty, for the body of the Virgin Mary was taken by her divine Son into the heavens. This is a celebration of our feast. It's a celebration, really, of Christ being the Lord over life and death. It's a celebration, again, of the power of Christ risen from the dead. That this power, which Christ himself has, because he is the firstborn of the dead, that he is the firstfruits of those who have fallen asleep, as the scripture says. Christ himself, by his own power, went to the place of death, Hades, hell, destroyed his power, opened his gates, we see that there, and taking Adam and Eve and all the righteous out of hell, bringing them, their souls, into the heavens. That our Lord destroying death, he has conquered death, that death doesn't exist anymore. That what we call biological death now is only a translation from what is corruptible to what is incorruptible, from what is earthly to what is heavenly. And the Lord gifted his mother as the second fruits of this resurrection from the dead. She being the mother of life, God the Holy Trinity wished to have the Son of God become the Son of Man. And so he chose Mary, this particular girl, to be his mother, that she would be the source of his human life. And Mary accepted the Son of God as the Son of Man. And when Mary was to leave this life, being the mother of life, the Son of divine life did not wish his mother to taste of decay. And so he put her beyond these ages of the kingdom to come already, that she is already beyond this age, that she and her divine Son are in the heavens, the kingdom of God, the only two biological bodies that are there of human flesh, the Virgin Mary and her divine Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. The general resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come, everyone will rise from the dead. Our bodies and souls will come together. And we hope that we will ascend in glory, as the Virgin Mary did, into the highest of the heavens. This is the foundation of our belief. This is the foundation of our expectation. This is the source of our joy, of our celebration. What we're celebrating on the death and burial and resurrection of the Holy Theotokos, we're celebrating Christ's lordship, that he has lordship over the living and the dead, that all things are in his hands. Usually, in our lives, we kind of think that our lives are our lives, that we have authority over our lives, and to a most extent, we do. But it's foolish for us really to believe that God is not instrumental in our life. Oftentimes we think, when a person dies, for example, we say, now they are in God's hands. As if they were not in God's hands before. We're always in God's hands. It's true to say that that person who dies is now in God's hands because they were always in God's hands. That our Lord Jesus Christ doesn't react to our condition, to our biological death, and then he does something, takes our soul and puts it with him or puts it in the antechambers of hell in Hades. That God doesn't react to us, that God acts for us all the time, that he's instrumental in his love for us all the time, that what carries a person in this life and the life beyond, and in the between aspect of biological death, is the love of God. That is the love of God that carries us. It's the love of God that is made manifest. It's the love of God that is powerful. And sometimes we say, well, okay, this is the teaching, but how do we know it? Well, we don't know it. It's the teaching because our Lord tells us that. But I am the resurrection and the life, and that he who believes in me, even if he dies, he shall yet live. But those are the words of the Lord. And so we believe that the Lord is the powerful one over life and death, that he is the Lord of life and death, that he is always with us in our life, in our dying, in our death, and in the age to come, he will be with us in his divine love. But the divine love needs to be experienced. It can't only be something that is talked about or known, or that it is a kind of cold doctrine. Oftentimes, we don't feel the warmth of the love of Christ. And why is that? Well, it's because we're not loving Christ, God, enough. Well, is it possible? Well, yes. What does our Lord teach us? I'm the Lord your God. Love me with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, all your mind. Not some of your mind, some of your time, some of your strength, some of your soul. The word is all, todo, all, with all our being, all ourself. And then our Lord teaches us, he says, if you really love me, how do you prove it? If you really love me, you will keep my teachings, my commandments. What are the teachings? What are the commandments? Well, the Bible is full of that for us. The Lord is always teaching us, telling us things about himself, telling us things about ourselves. And we have to abide in that love and to experience it, the warmth of the Son of Righteousness, Christ God, that love. So oftentimes, we don't feel that love, and we think that God is absent. God is no way absent in our life. But God loves everyone. St. Nicodemus the Hagarite says something very bold. He says that the love that Jesus Christ has for his mother, the Virgin Mary, that the same quality of that love he has for every human being. For every human being. So that there is no one in this world, regardless of where they live, how they live, what faith they have, what age they live to, that is not marked by the deep love that Christ has uniquely, personally, for that person. In other words, God, the Trinity of Persons, as manifested in our Lord Jesus Christ, the Eternal Word, loves us 100%. However, if we are full of self-love, then we close ourselves off from the love of God. When we are not attentive to God, when we disbelieve God, when we disobey God, then we feel that there's an absence, there's a kind of shame, there's a kind of break that we have. But it's not God breaking with us. It's us breaking with God. And so this festival again reminds us that we're always, always supported by the love of God in this life, in our dying, and in the age to come. Our beloved Apostle Paul, he writes so eloquently about that. He says this. He says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Who? And then he goes on and lists a whole bunch of things here. Things that could be troublesome for us. Things that we think would overwhelm us and cool our love or destroy that love. And then he lists things. He says, shall tribulation or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword, war. Will any of these things, he says, will this separate us from the love of Christ? It is written, for your sake we are killed all the day long, we are counted as sheep for the slaughter. So he's exposing to us, giving an expose for us of all those things that are terrible in life. We can say, well, then the love of God isn't made manifest yet. The love of God isn't secure for us. Says this, yet in all these things, in all these tribulations and sorrows and difficulties, yet in all these things we are more than conquerors, that we are triumphant, that we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. It's through Christ that we have power. It's through Christ, the love of Christ that abides in us, that we're able to accomplish and conquer all things. Paul goes on, he says, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities and powers, other heavenly beings, the demons, nor things that are present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. The love of God, which is always present, always being poured out upon each one of us in a personal way. Again, think of it this way. Oftentimes, we know we're sinners. We're far from God. We think that the Lord doesn't pay attention to me because I don't pay attention to him. Well, that's not true. It's true that we don't pay attention to him, but it's not true that he does not pay attention to us. He does not only pay attention to us, but he loves us uniquely, personally, wholeheartedly. He does everything that he can in that love for us, and he doesn't stop. When we break relationship with him, he doesn't break relationship with us. And so it's that love that carries us in our life. And we don't think of that because we are so consumed in self-love and determining things for ourselves. We're not transparent to the ways of God, to the glory of God. But that's what Jesus Christ teaches. When Jesus Christ comes to the earth, what does he do? He says, I don't do my will, but I don't teach you. I deliver to you what's been told to me by the Father. And my will is to do the will of my Father. That Jesus Christ is transparent to God the Father in his unity of love with him. He does everything for the love of the Father, and the Father does everything for the love of the Son. And the Holy Spirit completes that triune unity of the love that God has. For us Christians who have been baptized into Christ Jesus, that we've died already. When we were put into the font, we were drowned spiritually. That the font became the womb. That the font is the womb in which we're spiritually born again. And when we're immersed in the waters, we die to the old man, to the old self, to sinfulness, to spiritual death, which is the cause of everything. And we rise resurrected into newness of life. And we put on the garment of salvation. The garment of salvation is the life of Jesus Christ. That's what we wear, the life of Jesus Christ. That's the white garment, the radiant garment, the life of Jesus Christ. And doing so, this is what Apostle Paul says. Okay, if this is our life now, then how do we do it? He says this. He says, for none of us lives to himself. We don't live to ourselves now. Those that are baptized, chrismated, and accepted that abiding in the love of God. And no one dies to himself. If we live, we live to the Lord. So every day when we get up and we go about our business, we should be in our mind as we are living today to the Lord, for the Lord, for the glory of the Lord. That's foremost. And if we die, we die to the Lord. If we die spiritually in our sins, and those are washed away by the baptism and later by the holy confession, then that spiritual dying, we die to the Lord. And the biological death that we have, we die to the Lord anyway. Therefore, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. We belong to the Lord. He has lordship. And to this end, Christ died and rose and lived again, that he might be the Lord of both the living and the dead. And so this is our assurance. This is our assurance. That Christ rose from the dead. Every Sunday we're celebrating that, time and time again. We're always hearing every Sunday, especially in the evening service, the night before. We're always talking about death and dying. We're talking about the life of the age to come. We're talking about the resurrection. We're talking about the stone being removed from the tomb. We're talking about Christ appearing to the apostles, giving them the assurance that he's risen from the dead. It says here, touch, taste, that I'm not a ghost, but I'm risen from the dead. And I have lordship over life. And so this feast of the celebration of the Virgin Mary, it's a second fruits, as it were. It's a summer Pascha. That what we're celebrating, again, is God's giftedness to us. Because not only has he risen from the dead, ascended to heaven, is glorified by God the Father, but he has allowed his most pure mother, the mother of life, not to taste of decay, but but has translated her beyond this age into the kingdom of God. And so we have a second assurance through the person of the Khalifa al-Qaws that indeed we will rise from the dead, that indeed our lives, not only then in the age to come, but now, that we live in our Lord Jesus Christ, that it is his love which carries us, and we need to be in union with that love. That's why in the church we're always saying unto ages of ages, but we don't only say unto ages of ages. What are we saying first? Now. Now and ever and unto the ages of ages. And so let this feast of the celebration of the Holy Theotokos, the Ever Virgin Mary, let it be for us a source of spiritual renewal and of celebration. Let us live in such a way, as the Apostle Paul says, that all these things that seek to overwhelm us in this life, tribulations, necessities, distress, afflictions, sword, sinfulness, anything that's created, anything that is from the highest or the lowest, from the heights of the depth, anything that's created, that nothing, there is nothing and no one that can separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus. That we have to be assured about. That we have to believe. But not only to believe it, but we need to experience it. And how do we experience it again? Well, listening to the words of our Lord. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. What's the grace? The first and great commandment? You shall love the Lord your God with all your soul, all your strength, all your heart, all your mind. That's a 24/7 activity for us. But finally, this feast, we ask the Mother of God to be with us. That neither the tomb nor death can hold the Theotokos, was constant in prayer and our firm hope in her intercessions, that she is the one that is already in the kingdom of God. With her maternal love, she showers her blessings upon us, so that where she is with her divine Son, that we too could be one day to abide in that heavenly kingdom with her and all the saints through the ages. Amen. Glory to Jesus Christ. Amen.